just love to.
And welcome to Londonderry Christian Church, where we're here to love one more. We're so glad you've chosen to... I'm on, I think. Hey, there you go. Now, here we go. All right, let's try it all over again. Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Londonderry Christian Church, where we're here to love one more. My name is Dave. I'm the preaching pastor here at LCC. And we're so glad you've chosen to join us this morning as we gather together to celebrate the most important event in human history, the resurrection of Jesus. So we're so glad that you're here with us. I'm going to ask you to do something that we do sometimes on Easter. Other churches probably do this as well. And so I want to ask you to do a call and response. I'm going to say something. I'm going to ask you to reply back. So I'm going to say, "He is risen." I'm going to ask you to say, "Oh, not yet. Hold on. Be patient, people." All right. I'll say, "He is risen." And you reply back, "He is risen indeed." We're going to do that three times. The first time, be kind of normal tone. Second time, a bit louder. The third time, more loud to celebrate what has happened, the resurrection of Jesus, okay? So I'm going to say it, and then you respond back with, "He is risen indeed." All right, here we go. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hosanna.
Amen. Thank you. Yes, he is risen, and we're so excited to celebrate what the resurrection of Jesus means for us today. Again, as you're here with us this morning, if you look around the room, our room is getting pretty filled, which is great. If there are seats open to your right, you can head towards the wall to make room for others to come in. That would be great. We'd really appreciate that. Also, if you didn't pick up a communion cup on your way in, you can grab those out in the lobby, or our ushers will come by with a basket if you need one, and you can grab one of those. Also, as you leave today, if you want to help partner with our church and our mission to love one more by giving, you can place your giving in the offering box in the back, or you can set up online regular giving through your bank as well. So a few things I want to share with you that are upcoming. The first one is we have coming up at the end of June is our VBS program, Vacation Bible School. It's our kids program for kids age 3 to 5th grade. We're partnering with Orchard Christian Fellowship. It'll be hosted at their church over on Pillsbury Road. And so encourage all kids to sign up for that. You can go to orchardnh.org to sign up for VBS there. Just make sure you put down Londonderry Christian Church as the church you're coming from. And we also need volunteers. So if you like kids, if you love working with kids, if you kind of like kids, if you have free time that week, we would love to have your help that week. We would love to get as many people as possible to help us share Jesus with our kids that week. So as we celebrate Easter today, we're continuing in the sermon series we've been working through as we go through the book of Exodus. And we're going to look at what the Exodus story has to tell us about the resurrection of Jesus, how those things can go together. So I invite you, if you would, please say with me our theme verse for our series out of the book of Exodus. "Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment." Let's pray. Mighty God, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to come gather together to celebrate what you have done, the resurrection of your Son. God, that Jesus died for us, and now he lives again for us, and that because of his mighty and powerful resurrection, our lives can be different, our lives can be changed because of what you've done through Jesus. It's in his great name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. My name is Mark, and I'm on staff here at LCC. This morning in the band, I'm joined by Kevin and Anthony and Matt and Jess and Jesse. We're going to start off singing some songs and praise to God. If you'd like to stand and sing along with us, you're welcome to do so. If you're more comfortable seated, that's okay too. But I'm going to pray, and then we'll start singing some praise. God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for all of these people who get to come together, Lord, for a chance to celebrate what you've done for us through your Son, Jesus. God, we praise you and lift up that praise to your name today. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You showed up and passed me up like you do every time. I get amnesia. I forget that you keep coming around. Ain't no way you'll ever let me down. Good God Almighty.
No grave, gonna You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And now by day is a sign that you are with me, and the fire by night is a guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh. As you stepped into my Egypt and you took me by the hand, you marched me out in freedom into the promised land. And I will not forget you, I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You stepped into my Egypt, you took me by.
You can have a seat.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So again, happy Easter.
Happy Resurrection Sunday.
Our kids have been working on that song for the last couple weeks, so it's great to have them come up and participate with us in worship and share that song with us as we are able to worship together. And so again, as we mentioned earlier, today we're going to continue our journey in the book of Exodus, and we're going to look at two events that are pivotal in the history of God's people. The first one occurs in the book of Exodus, and the second one occurred many years later with the resurrection of Jesus. And so we're going to see, as we look at these stories, how Yahweh frees his people. We've been, as we've gone through the book of Exodus so far, we've been looking at this big theme that Exodus wants us to understand. And the theme is that Yahweh is a God who keeps his promise. That if you go all the way back to the book of Genesis, Yahweh makes promises to his people. He tells them he was going to make them into a great nation. He was going to give them the land that he promised them. He was going to bless them and bless all peoples through them. And so we see how through Genesis, God begins this process of keeping his promise, but he never quite gets there. And so at the end of Genesis, his people go down to Egypt because there's a famine. And God tells them that they're going to be there for a long time, but eventually he's going to lead them out of Egypt and into freedom. And so Exodus shows how God is fulfilling these promises. And so last week, we looked at what happened on the Passover and how God used that event of the people putting the sacrificial lamb's blood on their doorposts that led them to leaving Egypt. So today, we're going to look at the second half of that story. So the first half is they leave through Passover, and now we're going to get to the next part. We're going to see how God's going to keep his promise. So Yahweh keeps his promise to free his people. And so last week, it started with that sacrificial lamb and the judgment that came upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh and the gods of Egypt. And so the God's people are leaving. And as they leave, the Egyptians are like, yeah, get out of here. Like, go. You being here has turned out to be really, really bad for us. Please leave. Oh, and as you go, here's some silver. Here's some gold. Here's some clothing. Take our stuff as added incentive to leave quickly. Please go. Out of our house. Bye-bye. Vamanos. Go, go, go. That's what's happening. Except when they go, God does this crazy thing, and he leads his people with his presence in a pillar of cloud by day, in a pillar of fire by night. The presence of Yahweh goes before his people, but he doesn't take them on like the most direct or quickest path to get where they're going. He avoids that, and he kind of takes them on a wandering route, and at one point he takes them out to leave. And then he says, okay, now we're going to turn back and go back towards Egypt. And it says in the text that what happens is Pharaoh sees this and he's like, man, they're lost. Like, their God seemed powerful, but he seems like he doesn't know what he's doing. Like, the map, you go from here to there, there's a road to get there. They don't take it. Instead, now that they've doubled back to where we are. And so Pharaoh decides, man, we've been out without these people for a few days now, and that's slave labor. Like, he can't beat it. That was a bad thing to say on Easter. That labor they had, not good. Wow, that was bad. Whew. And he decides, I want my slaves back. And so he gets his chariot army, and they go pursue God's people. And the text tells us that God's people are camped by this place called Migdol and the sea. And so Pharaoh's army comes to take these slaves back. And so what we're seeing in this story is that Yahweh is going to free his people by saving them. That he's going to do an act of power to save his people, and that through that act of power, he's going to free them and lead them out of slavery, and they will no longer have this problem that they've had with Egypt. No more worry about being slaves in Egypt. No more worry about Pharaoh or the gods of Egypt. Yahweh is going to free his people. And this story we see is not unlike one that we find in the New Testament. That in this story in Exodus, Yahweh appears like he doesn't know what he's doing. His people look lost. They are ripe for capture by Pharaoh. And in the New Testament, we find this story about this man Jesus. Jesus had come on the scene. He begins teaching, saying the kingdom of God is near. He does all kinds of amazing, wonderful miracles. He begins to confront the religious leaders. They don't like that. And eventually he's arrested, beaten, and killed. And his people don't know what's going on. They had hopes. They had dreams that this man, Jesus, was going to be the Messiah, the one to come save God's people, to lead them out of captivity to Rome. They were going to be freed by this new king. He was going to come in conquering power. He was going to kick the Romans out, and God's people would be able to rule themselves again. And instead of a mighty victory parade, they see him placed on a cross. And it seems as if Yahweh doesn't know what he's doing. It appears that his people again are lost. In both stories, we're going to see that God's people have this problem we have to overcome. That if we're going to be freed, we have to overcome this first problem. That is that we often encounter fear when we find freedom. And so Yahweh, as he wants to free his people, wants to free us from fear. That as God frees his people, we are freed from fear. Look at Exodus chapter 14, starting in verse 10. As Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and cried out to Yahweh. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone. Let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than die in the desert." Now again, it says that God's people are camped between Migdol and the sea. And so Pharaoh comes after them with his chariot army. I've never seen a chariot in action, or really seen a herd of horses in action. But one time, I saw a herd of cows all running together at the same time, at night. It was terrifying. Those are big animals that can move quickly. And so imagine that before you is this chariot army galloping full speed with warriors, with spears and weapons on the chariots, and they're coming to you. And you have no weapons, no armor, no shields. And behind you is a sea. For God's people, they had death before them and death behind them. They had nowhere to go. And so their response is a common response, probably the same response we would have. They respond with fear. We're going to die. Oh, they're coming for us. I can't swim. And they get a bit ridiculous. They say to Moses, like, "Weren't there graves in Egypt? Why are we here to die in the desert?" Then they go even farther. "Didn't we tell you? We liked being slaves in Egypt. Why did you bring us out? We didn't ask for freedom." And they responded with fear. Fear hijacks our bodies. That when we have a response or a situation that calls for a response of fear, fear takes over everything about us. Our heart rate goes up. We get sweaty. We get nervous. It makes us focus on the present, the right now. There is danger. I've got to do something. And typically we either fight, flight, or freeze. God's people are afraid. And because they're afraid, they're thinking of right now. Even though just a few days before this, God had acted in a mighty way to lead them out of Egypt. He did 10 acts of judgment upon Egypt, increasing in power and justice. And so the God they're following just did a great thing to get them out of Egypt. Yeah, they're here, they're at the death before, death behind. What are we going to do? We're going to die. Ah! Because they're afraid. Sometimes, when we're given the opportunity to live in freedom, we don't know how to handle it. And our response can be fear. And we see the same thing happen in the story of Jesus. Look at Mark chapter 16. Starting in verse 1, it says, "When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, 'Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?' But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which is very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. 'Don't be alarmed,' he said. 'You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go tell his disciples and Peter. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you.' Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid." You have these women who are going to finish the burial rites for Jesus. And when they arrive at the tomb, they find the unexpected. They expect the large stone to be there, and instead it's moved out of the way. And this young man, it says in the text, other versions tell us it's an angelic visitor, an angel has appeared, who gives them a message from God that Jesus isn't there. He is risen just as he said. Amazing, wonderful, life-changing good news. But their response is they're trembling and bewildered, and they go away afraid. As sometimes when we are offered freedom, we don't know how to respond, and so we respond with fear. Partly because we've lived so long in slavery, and in our case, slavery to sin, that we become comfortable trying to live life our way. We've talked over the last many weeks how our major problem, the sin that we all struggle with, is this sin of trying to be God. Now, none of us would probably say, yeah, I'm God, but we try in our lives to live as if we're the ones in charge. We try to control what we can, whether it's our kids or our spouses or our jobs or our money or our lives. We try to make it all go the way we want it to. And that doesn't work. And it falls apart because we make really, really bad gods. But we try to live that way because we're used to it. We're comfortable there. And yet what we're seeing in the story is that when God offers us freedom, we have to let go of our chains and let go of that fear to live in a new way. Jesus is alive. The world has forever been changed, and we are changed because Jesus is alive. That now we can live in freedom. Rather than going back and putting on the chains of slavery again, we can live in a new way, letting God be God and lead us as he led his people. Yahweh has freed us from fear. We don't have to live afraid. And because he's freed us from fear, we are freed to trust him. Look at Exodus chapter 14, starting in verse 13. It says, "Moses answered the people, 'Do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance Yahweh will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. Yahweh will fight for you. You need only to be still.'" When you're afraid, there's not much that seems less effective than someone to tell you, don't be afraid. They're coming! For God's people, the chariots are bearing down, death before, death behind. Moses says, here's what God says, three things we need to do. Do not fear, stand firm, be still. That sounds like terrible advice when a chariot's coming for you. Like, God says, here's what you should do. Stand where you are. But Moses, chariots, sea, death. Don't fear. Stand firm. Be still. And Moses says, Yahweh will fight for you. That when we begin to let go of our fear, we're invited to trust God. And that's what is happening here. There's nothing Israel can do to stop Pharaoh's army. They don't have the weapons, they don't have the training, they don't have the equipment. They can do nothing. So God says, yeah, you can do nothing. I can do it. Yahweh will save his people because in the midst of their fear, he invites them to trust him and he will save them. And we see the same thing happen in the resurrection of Jesus. Look again at Mark chapter 16, verse 7. It says, but go, tell his disciples and Peter. He's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. The women are afraid, but they're given an invitation in the midst of their fear to go trust God. They don't understand what they're seeing. They go to the tomb. The tomb is empty. There's an angel. They're bewildered. They're confused. But God says, trust me. Go share the message. Tell the disciples, tell Peter that you will see Jesus in Galilee. Go share the story. That in the middle of our fear, when our body's trying to be hijacked by fear, it's an opportunity for us to trust God in the midst of our fear. The way we overcome fear is not by going back to our chains, by going back to our sin, but it's to trust the God who saves us. Because our freedom does not come through our energy, effort, or expense. Our freedom does not come through our energy, effort, or expense. It's not about how passionate we are about something, how much energy we have to try to fight something. If the Israelites were like, chariots are coming, we got to run, doesn't matter how fast they are, how much energy they built up to run away, they're not getting away. It doesn't matter how much effort we put into it, how many good things we try to do, how much we read the Bible or don't, how much we pray or we don't, how much we go to church or we don't. That effort's not going to save us. It doesn't matter how much money we have or we don't have, or how much money we give or we don't give. Our energy, effort, and expense will not free us, because our freedom comes through God's grace. Our freedom comes through an act that only God can do. That was the case with Egypt when they're stuck between death before and death behind. They can do nothing. And the same is true for us. No matter how much we try to manage our lives as God, we can't do it. Only God can be God. Only he can save us through an act that he alone can do. And so we are freed through God's power. That's what happened as Israel is stuck between death before and death behind. It says, God tells Moses, go out before the sea and raise the staff of God in your hand. Stretch out your hand over the waters and the seas will divide. That's what Moses does. He goes out and holds up the staff And it says a strong east wind blows and the water is divided as it was back in Genesis 1 when God divided water from water. He divides it. There's a wall of water on the left, a wall of water on the right. And God's people walk through on dry land. Which is also amazing. I grew up swimming in a man-made lake as a kid. The first 20 feet of the lake were amazing. It was wonderful sand. Once you got past that, it was disgusting, icky mud on the bottom. One of those were like, I would touch it and be like, ugh! You didn't want to be there. God divides the water and the wind is so powerful, it dries the mud into dry ground. And his people walk through. As they do, it says the presence of God, the angel of God, goes behind them, and the pillar of cloud, pillar of fire, blocks their way so that the Egyptian army cannot get to them until they get to the other side. And then the presence of God moves, and the Egyptian army comes pursuing them. They get far enough after them that God then tells Moses, go stretch out your arm again. And the water flows back. And it covers the Egyptian army. And God's people is saved through a mighty act of his power. There's nothing that God's, they can't do that. They can't make the water stack up. They can't divide it on their own. That was God doing an amazing act. That was a pivotal moment in Israel's history. Throughout the rest of their history, they keep looking back to this event of, look at what God did. Look at what God did. Look at his power. He led us out of Egypt and defeated the Egyptian army. How amazing is that? That was a pinnacle and pivotal moment where God freed them through his power. And that pinnacle moment points forward to the pinnacle moment, the moment that has changed history, when God raised Jesus back from the dead. That event changed everything for everyone, everywhere. And Paul reflects on this in Romans chapter 6. Look at Romans chapter 6, starting in verse 1. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Oh, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we've been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. That Paul, as he reflects on the resurrection of Jesus, he says, we have been set free. We've been set free from the power of sin, that the death of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus has opened the way for us to be in a relationship with God. And now the blood of Jesus covers over us so that our sin has been removed. We've been protected by the blood of Jesus. And the resurrection means that we are now free to live a new life in the power of Jesus. That when Yahweh raised Jesus to life, he broke the chains of fear that hold us in slavery to sin. And death has been broken forever. That we can now live new lives and free lives. Now, part of what that means, it doesn't mean that we will never sin again or that we won't die. That the reality is, as we follow Jesus, we will sin. There will be days, there will be times that we will try to sit back on the throne of our life and live as God. But the good news is because of the death and resurrection, that sin has already been covered over and paid for. And so we can repent and say, God, I'm sorry. Yeah, I know I'm not you. Help me stop trying to do that and to live and surrender to you. And the resurrection means that we have new power to live differently. And it may be a slow journey at first of slowly becoming more and more like Jesus, but he will not give up on us. He will not leave us. He won't say, I'm done with you. He won't say, why can't you get it? He will not cast us aside because he has freed us through his power. We've been set free to live in freedom. But that means we have a choice. See, Yahweh offers us freedom. So we have a choice. Do we want to live in freedom or do we want to live in slavery? Mark chapter 16, verse 6 says, Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. Because Jesus is alive, because the tomb is empty, we have a choice. We can choose to put our chains back on, and to go back living in slavery, to keep trying to live as if we're God, to keep trying to manage and control our lives as if we're the ones in charge, and keep failing, and keep having it blow up in our face because that's what happens. Or we can choose to live in freedom, to allow the power of Jesus to be at work in us, to trust and follow Jesus, even when we're afraid, even when we don't understand, even when things get hard, but to say, because Jesus is alive, I'm going to live in his way. So we have a choice. We can choose to live in our old way, or we can accept what he's done for us, trust him, follow him, and live in freedom. So Yahweh is a God who keeps his promise. And he's opened the way for you to live in freedom. All you have to do is trust in Jesus. To accept what he's done for you. And live in his freedom by following him. We're going to sing a song together to celebrate what God has done for us. As we do so, we're going to offer a time of response. Maybe you're in a place this Easter morning where you've been trying to live as if you're God. You've been trying to be the one in charge, that you keep trying to manage and do things your way, and it's not gone the way you want it to. If you're ready today to surrender and to trust Jesus, we're going to have an opportunity that you could take that step to say, I want to surrender to Jesus through the act of baptism. To go into the water, to be laid down into it to signify you have died with Christ and you've been raised back to life to live a new life in freedom. If you'd like to take that step today, I'll be in the back. I'd love to talk to you and we could see you make that decision and go through that today, this Easter morning. Maybe you're in a place that you have questions. That this whole Jesus stuff, what it means to follow him and what God has done for us, you don't understand it or you have something holding you back that you just like to talk about. I'll be in the back. I'd love to talk to you or set up a time that we could talk further about whatever's holding you back. Or maybe you're in a place where things are hard right now. That you're trying your best to trust God, but there's stuff happening that you're afraid. And so you could use someone to come alongside you and just pray with you. That in the midst of your fear, you could let go of fear and grab hold of Jesus and trust God through it. If you want to be baptized, if you want to talk, if you want to say yes to Jesus, I'll be in the back. Please come talk to me.
Church, we're going to sing a song in response. If you'd like to stand with us, you're welcome to do so. If you want to stay seated, that's great too.
Devil roars his empty threats. I will preach the gospel to myself that I am not a man condemned, for Jesus Christ is my defense. My sin is nailed to the cross,
God brought his people out of Egypt. He left them a Passover communion or a Passover supper that reminded them of the power he had done to free them from Egypt. The slaughtering of a lamb, the blood on the doorpost, that through that simple act, they could be free. 2,000 years later, Jesus Christ was about to be crucified. And the night before he was crucified, he left a little ceremony for his people about breaking bread, which represents his body being broken the next day on the cross, about the blood being poured out, the juice, for our sins. Instead of putting the blood on the doorpost, we put the blood on our hearts, and we take Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior to remind us not to live in fear, to be still, and to wait on his power. There's nothing we can really do to save ourselves. It's that simple and that hard, but follow him, trust in him, and live in his freedom. So every week we remind ourselves of this by enjoying communion together. We simply take a piece of bread that represents his body broken, We drink a little bit of juice to represent the blood shed for us, and we celebrate his resurrection. So we can do that together if you want to open the top. We got the cracker. This represents Jesus' body. And the night before he was betrayed, he took the bread. When he gave him thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Dear Lord, just thank you for the wonderful power you've done by sending your son down here to sacrifice himself for us so we may enjoy your freedom. Thank you. In Jesus' name.
Church, we're going to sing one last song together in celebration of what God has done for us this Easter. If you'd like to stand and sing along with us, you can do so.
Thank you.
you so much for being here with us this Easter morning. We hope that you felt a little bit of God's presence today, that when we come together, God is with us, but when we leave, God is still with us. And so it's not just about being here in this building, but as we go out, we have Love One More written on our church. Our goal is as we go out, we show God's love to the world around us. We have a couple quick announcements, and then we will let you all get out of here. First, this is our final week of giving for the Ukraine, so if you have a gift that you'd like to give to the Ukraine, we have a basket in the back that we can do that with. Yeah, you can have a seat. Sorry, I forgot that part. We have our core values there on the back wall. They're illuminated in pink this morning. One of them is everyone in ministry. And so one of our goals is that if you're here at LCC and this is your regular church home, that you would find a way to put the gifts that God's given you and the skills that he's given you and the talents and the passions that he's given you into practice. And one of the ways that you can do that is in our kids ministry. Ashley has been heading that up and doing a wonderful job. As you saw this morning, she led the students singing along with us and all of that. So there's some really cool stuff happening in the kids area, but we could use a lot of help. So if that's something that you are gifted in, or at least willing to help until we find more people who are gifted in that, we'd love to have you with that. And lastly, as Dave said this morning, we're teaming up with Orchard Christian Fellowship down the street for VBS this summer. So if you'd like some more info on that, you can reach out to one of us in the staff and we'll help you with that. So other than that, I will pray, and then the band will play some walkout music, and you can head out and have a great Easter, have a great lunch, or whatever you're going to do with your family. Thanks again for being here with us, and have a great week. God, we love you. We thank you so much for a chance to come together, God, to praise your name, to hear from your word, and to spend some time together as a church family, God, in your presence. Lord, keep it in our minds that we know that your presence isn't here in this room, in these walls, inside of this place here at Londonderry. God, you are with us when we go out. Lord, help us to love one more. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Thanks again for being with us. Happy Easter.